And I have to say, there's a lot of firsts for me in this, and I'm really excited to be here, and it's an honor to talk to you, but I have never spoken at 6:30 in the morning before in my entire life, it's a true testament to how much harder my brother works than I do, that he's up, but it's fascinating. What you guys do, I'm in awe of doctors and have been my whole life growing up in a medical family. And I'm going to tell a little story about pretty much how I got to the books that I'm known for. I guess the two stories I'm known for are Bringing Down the House, which became the movie 21, which was the, if any of you gamble, was the big card counter MIT kids taking on Vegas. And then The Social Network, which was based on my book, Accidental Billionaires, about Mark Zuckerberg and the bizarre going on at Facebook. But I never set out to be a nonfiction writer. I actually always hated nonfiction growing up. I found it very boring, and I was actually obsessed with television. This is going to date myself, but really bad TV, like Saved by the Bell and Three's Company, if any of you ever watched those shows. And I think my parents, fearing the worst, set a rule when we were little that we had to read two books a week before we were allowed to watch TV. So I basically became a speed reader very early on in my life so that I could watch Three's Company. Yeah, I do remember the story, Josh, about your, I hope you've got your J's right now, but I did get him by writing on the piano with the J backwards. It was very crafty. But so I was a... I became a reader, you know, to watch television, and by the time I graduated from college, I realized I wanted to be a writer. But I didn't know what kind of writer I wanted to be, so I basically locked myself in a room in Boston, and I wrote 9 novels, and they were deep, dark stories that take place in bars in New York City, because I was reading Bret Easton Ellis and Jay McInerney, and I thought that's what writers write. And consequently, I got rejected by everyone in New York City. I had 190 rejection slips. Taped to all of my walls. I looked like a serial killer with them all around me. And I even was rejected by a janitor at a publishing house because I wrote a manuscript and I sent it to an editor who was no longer working there. And then it ended up in the trash can and the janitor took it out of the trash and he read it and then he rejected me. So it was kind of sad, the quality of my writing. But I kept going and I kept going, and eventually an editor at Random House called me up. And he said, I'm not going to publish any of the crap that you've been writing, but go read John Grisham and come back in a year. And so I read John Grisham, and I read Michael Crichton, and I read all these thrillers. And this was kind of the dawn of ER, and the medical thrillers were just starting to get hot, and my dad is a doctor. And so I decided I'm going to write a medical thriller. So my first book was a medical thriller called Threshold, which, don't worry, none of you have ever heard of, because it sold about 8 copies. But it was about... An evil scientist who was implanting genetic diseases in people, and people were dying of these genetic diseases. And it was just good enough to get me a second book, which was another medical thriller, which was called Reaper, which again, none of you have ever heard of, which was about a computer virus that makes the jump to the biological world, and people start getting sick from their television sets. And I came up with the idea after a really bad episode of Oprah, I remember. And it was, you know, it was trashy. It ended up being made into a TV movie. Called Fatal Error, which I hope none of you have seen, but it still airs at about 2 in the morning on the Sci-Fi channel, and it stars Antonio Sabato Jr., if you remember. He was the Calvin Klein underwear model. I think he was on Melrose Place. He was Heather Locklear's boyfriend on Melrose Place. Some of you remember him. And he plays a surgeon, which was very believable casting. I didn't realize that surgeons did so many sit-ups in between patients, because that's pretty much all he did. And I remember watching the movie with my dad, who I said is a doctor, and there's a scene where Antonio Sabato Jr. is leaning over this patient's chest, and he goes, "We've got a subdural hematoma." And my dad turned to me and goes, "You know that's in the head, right?" So it was a true quality of what was going on there. I learned my first rule of Hollywood when that movie came out. I was basically ranked below the caterer on the movie set. The writer is the lowest of the low in Hollywood. I remember I couldn't even get into the wrap party. because there was copies of my books on the walls, but they wasn't on the list, and I didn't get in until I was part of Antonio Sabato Jr.'s entourage. So I went from there, and I actually was hired by the X-Files television show. A lot of you remember the X-Files. They called me up because I guess they liked Fatal Error, and they asked if I would move to L.A. and write for them. And at the time, I didn't really drive. I wasn't a real driving person. I didn't want to live in L.A. So I convinced them to let me write a book starring Mulder and Scully. So I wrote a thriller called Skin, which again was another medical-type thriller. It was about a skin transplant gone bad. It was based on my brother's experiences at the Skin Bank in New York. But it was about a professor who gets a transplant from a murderer, and then he starts killing people, and then Mulder and Scully have to track the skin back to its source. This was really cheesy. And they end up in Thailand, where I'd never been, and I wrote the whole book from a Fyodor's guidebook. So that was the quality of the stuff I was writing at the time. And it was about that time, I was really just looking for another, sci-fi medical thriller. And I hang out in Boston, I live there, and I was at this bar. I don't know if any of you have went to MIT or know the area, but there's this kind of dive bar near MIT called Crossroads, and it's like an MIT dive bar, if you can imagine what that would look like, full of math science guys in the corner. And there was this one group of guys who were like all the other MIT kids, except for they had tons of money, and it was always in $100 bills. And the thing is, in Boston, you never see $100 bills. I mean, it's probably similar out here. In New York, you see $100 bills. In Vegas, they come right out of the ATM machines, right? But you never see them in Boston. And so I remember going up to this kid. In the book, I called him Kevin Lewis, because when the book came out, he didn't want to be known as the blackjack guy. When the movie 21 came out, he did want to be known as the blackjack guy. So his real name was Jeff, so now I use his real name. And I went up to Jeff, and I said, why do you have so much money, and why is it always in $100 bills? And Jeff was like, well, come over to my apartment. I want to show you something. So I went to his place in the South End in Boston, and it was a much nicer apartment than he should have had at his age. And he points to his laundry, and stacked above his laundry was $250,000 in banded stacks of hundreds. And immediately I thought something weird is going on, because that's an enormous amount of money to have in cash. So I thought, oh, this guy's got to be a drug dealer. But he was Asian. I didn't even know if there were Asian drug dealers. And he was like, really nice guy, very good at math, so I didn't think he really was. And he basically invited me to go to Vegas with him the next day. And I was at a time in my life where I could just go to Vegas the next day, because I was a basically unemployed writer. So my dad was footing the bill, so it was a really good time for me. And so I basically got on the plane with him and a bunch of his buddies, and they all sat in different seats, and they pretended they didn't know each other, which was strange. And when we landed in Vegas, there was a uniformed limo driver, and he comes out, Mr. Lewis, your car is ready. And that wasn't even this guy's name. And the car takes us to this suite in Vegas, and it was the biggest suite I'd ever seen, like all glass, overlooking the whole strip. We had a swimming pool. We had a butler, and we didn't even know what to do with a butler, but we had a butler. And all the MIT kids start coming in the room, and they start pulling money out from under their clothes. And they pile it up on the table in the middle of the room, and it was $1 million in cash. And it was stacked up. They had flown with it under their clothes from Boston. And they said, we're the MIT blackjack team. And so I had heard of something called the MIT blackjack team living in Boston. I thought it was like a math club where they learned how to play blackjack. But the reality was this had been going on for 25 years. These secrets of blackjack had been passed down from group of students to group of students. And this group of five kids, well, really six, had won $6 million playing blackjack. And I was blown away, because I'd been writing all this crap that I was coming up with on my own, and here was a true story that was better than everything I was, coming up with. And so I convinced them to let me join the team for a few months and write their story. And a lot of you have seen the movie 21, but I like to go over the broad strokes in case any of you are on your way to a casino anytime soon. Blackjack is a beatable game, because blackjack has a memory. And what that means is, unlike other games in a casino, the game of blackjack changes as you play. Every time a card comes out of the deck, it's no longer in the deck. So if all the aces come out of a blackjack deck, you're not going to get blackjack anymore. This is different than roulette, for instance. Every spin of the wheel has nothing to do with the next spin. It doesn't matter how many times you spin red, it doesn't change your odds of spinning red. even though the casino would like you to think it does. And you go to the casino and next to a roulette wheel, they'll publish all of the last 10 winning numbers, which is completely nonsensical. It doesn't mean anything. But they want you to think it means something. Blackjack, it actually does mean something. And so that all that card counting is sitting at a table watching the cards come out of the deck. You keep track of the high cards and the low cards. When more low cards have come out of the deck, it means that there are more high cards in the deck, and you're going to win more often because you're going to get blackjack more often. The dealer's going to bust more often. So you sit there, you watch the cards, you keep track of high and low cards. When you know there's more high cards in the deck, you raise your bet. And you're going to win a little bit more, and that's all that card counting is. Now, the problem with card counting is that casinos frown upon it. there's nothing illegal about it. You can't go to jail for using your brain in a casino. But the casino, if they catch you doing it, will kick you out or worse, which we'll get to in a second. So what the team did, the MIT team, is they would spread 10 college kids out across the casino floor, one kid sitting at each blackjack table, and he's just acting like a regular college kid. He's playing blackjack, he's playing the minimum, and he's actually keeping track of all the cards. He signals in the guy called the big player, and the big player is looking like a rich, drunk high roller, always smells of alcohol, wanders around the casino, sits down at the table, bets $10,000 a hand. Then he gets the signal that the cards are no longer good, and he keeps walking around the casino. So in this way, you're only betting $10,000 bets on winning decks. And you can earn about 2% per hand playing with this system, which doesn't sound like a lot, but you're betting $10,000 a hand. You can very quickly win a couple $100,000. The other thing the MIT team did was use casinos' own stereotypes against them. A casino has an idea of what a high roller looks like. If a white guy with glasses from Boston comes into a casino with a duffel bag with $1 million in cash, that looks really weird, because I'm not what a high roller looks like. But if an Asian guy or a Persian guy walks into a casino with $1 million in cash, that actually looks normal, because nowadays most high rollers are Asian and Persian. So the MIT team would recruit as many Asians and Persians as they could. If you've been to MIT, you know that wasn't that hard, because maybe 60% of the school was Asian and Persian. Also, women can get away with anything in a casino, because the casinos are very chauvinistic, and they simply don't believe that women can do math. I remember interviewing an attractive blonde who was on the MIT blackjack team, and she would go into the casino wearing a tennis outfit and a tennis skirt on. She would carry a tennis racket, and she would sit at the table and be like, oh, my boyfriend's playing tennis. I'm so bored. I'm going to bet his money. And she would throw $10,000 out. And the reality was, you know, she's an applied math economics major at MIT. Everyone thinks she's this dumb blonde, and she would get away with it for hours. Also, when an attractive woman is in a casino, especially with a low-cut top on, all of those thousands of cameras that are on the ceiling are all focused on her. And this is true. I was in the Venetian security room, and all of the cameras were on. You could see all the, you know, TV screens. And they were following this one woman walking through the casino. And I was like, is she about to rob the place? And they're like, no, should we just get bored back here? And so the MIT team would recruit as many women as they could. If you knew these guys, that was a whole lot harder than getting Asians and Persians. They did not know a lot of women. One of the saddest stories from my Vegas, I went with these guys, and they were given a suite at the Palms, and it was this huge suite with a glass shower in the middle of the living room, and it was 9 guys sitting around the shower, and they're like, I wish we knew some girls. And that was pretty much their experience. But the MIT team would recruit as many women as they could. Eventually, they took to hiring strippers. Is this the first time anyone's spoken about strippers in this room? I bet. Unless plastic surgery comes down here, I don't know. But they would hire strippers who would sit at the end of the table to distract all the cameras, so all the security would be watching the stripper, and then they would do their thing. And so eventually they were winning an enormous amount of money, and the money became the biggest issue, because it's not illegal to go in and out of Vegas with $1 million of your own money. There's nothing illegal about flying from Logan to McCarran Airport with a duffel bag full of money. However, if you get caught in Logan Airport with a duffel bag full of money, and I won't necessarily go into how I know this because my parents are sitting right there, but I do know this, you end up in a cell beneath Logan Airport, handcuffed to a chair, and the DEA comes in and the IRS comes in and all these three-letter agencies come in, and they take your money away, and you spend about 6 months trying to get your money back. So the MIT team would carry the money under their clothes like in the movie. Pre-9/11, you could wear a coat on a plane. Remember that? And so in a coat, you can fit a couple hundred thousand dollars. In a hat, you can fit $10,000. You'd have bands around your legs with thousands of dollars. And you would reach McCarran Airport, you would trade the money underneath the stalls, and you would hit the various casinos. At some point, they decided to start keeping the money on the MIT campus. A couple of the kids actually broke into an administration building, and they found a safe dating all the way back to World War II that used to hold the MIT payroll. It was this massive lead safe. It had gone into disuse. So the MIT kids cracked the safe, and they would keep their money on campus. And, you know, every Friday they would make a withdrawal from the safe. Every Sunday they'd come back and put the money back in the safe. And when the team stopped playing, they decided they wanted the safe as a souvenir. So they went with a flatbed truck at 3 in the morning, and they winched this giant safe up, and they put it on the truck, and it broke the axle of the truck. They had to get a second truck. They got the safe onto the second truck, and they brought it to a house in Brookline, Mass., where it is now sunk 2 feet into the basement of this house. I know where the safe is. MIT actually came to me to try and get the safe back after I wrote the book, but I wouldn't tell them where it is. But I do know where it is. Eventually, the team did get caught. What happens when you get caught initially is something called a soft bar. So you're sitting at the table, you're playing blackjack, and two very large men walk up behind you. And they get very close to you. They go into your personal space. Because you haven't done anything illegal. You know, you haven't broken a law, so they can't arrest you. But if you push somebody, you've assaulted somebody. So they try and lean over you, and they say, you know, Mr. Mezrich, for instance, you're not allowed to play blackjack here anymore. And so you just leave. On the top of the MIT piece of paper they give out to the team, it says, when in doubt, just run. Because you haven't done anything wrong, they're not allowed to kidnap you, just get out of there. If you keep coming back, they'll eventually back room you. You do not want to go to the back room of a casino. That's the room where there aren't any cameras, they make you sit there, they take pictures of you, they stand you against the wall. You'll always hear people in the hallway talking about taking a drive out into the desert. Not that they'll actually do that, but they do have that conversation in front of you. And at that point, you know you're finished. You're a dinosaur. Eventually, the MIT team all became dinosaurs, and they couldn't play anymore. So basically, I wrote this story, and it was in a manuscript form, and I actually wrote an article for Wired magazine about it. And I was sitting at home, and the phone rang, and it was Kevin Spacey. At least the guy who said he was Kevin Spacey. I didn't believe it was Kevin Spacey. I remember calling my mom and saying, I think Kevin Spacey's trying to call me. And she was like, no, it's the MIT team prank calling you. Because they used to prank call me all the time. But I found out it actually was Kevin Spacey, so I called him back, and he was like, I want to make a movie out of this. And I was like, oh, okay, let's make a movie. That sounds great. So we took it out in Hollywood, and it was rejected by every studio except for MGM. Which coincidentally was the casino system we had been hitting for about 4 years. So we were like, do you guys really want to make this movie? Or are you going to make this movie go away? And they said, no, we love this movie because it makes people think they can beat blackjack. And the reality is, to join the MIT team, you had to practice 3 hours a day for 6 months. You had to take tests in secret fake casino environments. They would have you drink or throw drinks at you to make you, you know, mess up the count. And if you made one mistake an hour, it was worse than not card counting at all because you're going to be betting at the wrong time. So to join the team was very difficult. I actually always see people reading the book or watching the movie on the way to Vegas, and I feel really bad. That's the worst time to read this book because you're not going to just walk into a casino and beat blackjack. It takes a lot of practice. So I always want to refund people when they read the book on the way. You should read it on the way home from Vegas. Basically, 21 was about to come out, and I was at home again. Most of my life happens when I'm just sitting at home, so I try and sit at home as much as possible. I got an email at 3 in the morning, and it was from a Harvard senior. And this guy wrote me and said, my best friend co-founded Facebook, and no one's ever heard of him. And it was a strange little email to get at 3 in the morning. I knew about Mark Zuckerberg. Remember, this was before Facebook was the monster it is today. There were about 150 million members at the time. So it was still the size of a small country, but it wasn't the monster it was. And all I'd ever heard of was a guy named Mark Zuckerberg. So I went out for a drink with this guy in Boston, and he walks in with Eduardo Saverin. Some of you have seen The Social Network. Eduardo was just like in the movie. Not as good looking as Andrew Garfield, but he was, you know, very puppy dog-ish, really nice, naive guy. Proceeds to get extremely drunk, and he starts off the conversation by saying, Mark Zuckerberg fucked me. That's probably something else that's never been heard in this room, but... and I was like, wow, that's an interesting start to a conversation. And he starts to tell me this story. And it was two best friends at Harvard geeky kids who met in an underground Jewish fraternity. They were social misfits, very nerdy. They could not meet girls. They wanted to be members of one of the finals clubs at Harvard, which are those ultra-secret all-male organizations that date back 300 years. Eduardo got into one of the finals clubs. Mark had no shot of getting into a finals club. Late one night, Mark went on a date with a girl named Erica, and we know this from his blogs. He gets home from the date, and he drinks a couple beers. She had dumped him. And he hacks into the computer systems at Harvard, and he pulls up photos of every girl on campus, and he makes a website where you could vote on who the hottest girl at Harvard is. He also had a part in it where he was going to compare girls to farm animals. That's just, you know, what his thinking is. I remember when he got caught, he was even surprised that women were mad at him because in the comparison, they were beating the farm animals. So he thought they shouldn't be upset. But this gives you an idea of how he thinks. But basically, he leaked it to a couple friends. It spreads all over Harvard. Everyone tries to log on at the same time, and it nearly crashes Harvard's computer servers. Mark becomes infamous on campus. He nearly gets kicked out of school. And that's when he catches the attention of the Winklevi twins. You couldn't invent these guys if you wanted to, right? 6'5", identical twin Olympic rowers. They were the cool kids on campus. They were members of the Porcelain Club, which is the ultimate finals club. It's so secret you can only go in the front area. Supposedly, if you turn 30 and you're a member of the Porcelain and you haven't made your first million, they give you $1 million. Now, that's probably not true. I don't actually believe that, but that's the rumor. And these were the cool kids on campus. I remember meeting them for the first time in a hotel, and the Winklevi, I don't know, Cameron, Ty, I don't know which one it was, and he's like, you look at us and you assume that we must be the bad guys in this story, because if this were an 80s movie, we would be chasing the Karate Kid around the gym. But to their idea, they were the good guys. They saw Mark in the paper, and they needed a nerd, because they were working on their own website. It was called theharvardconnection.com, and the idea behind the website was it was going to help women meet Harvard men. Harvard men spend a lot of time trying to figure out ways to help women meet Harvard men. This was their idea. So they saw Mark. They decided to try and hire Mark. Mark didn't think their idea was very good. He thought it was a stupid idea. But he wanted to hang out with the cool kids on campus. So he said, sure, I'll help you with your idea. Meanwhile, he went back to his friend Eduardo. And he said, Eduardo, I have an idea for a website. People can put their own pictures up. We won't get in trouble. If you put up the money, which at the time was $1,000, I will let you be CFO and you can have 30% of the company. It was just two kids in a dorm room. There's no lawyers. There's no written anything. It was really just two friends. Eduardo puts up the $1,000, which ends up being the greatest investment in the history of the world, literally. And Mark goes and writes Facebook. It takes him 2 or 3 weeks to write the code. He spreads it out, and you know, and the rest is history. Within a month, everyone at Harvard is on Facebook. It starts going from school to school, first at the Ivy Leagues. It goes to Stanford University, and that's when it catches the attention of Sean Parker, who Justin Timberlake played in the movie very well. Sean was the cool kid of Silicon Valley, you know, whatever that means. He's nerdy, but he wears Armani. He walks into a restaurant. Every girl knows him. Very social. He's the kid who dropped out of high school to create Napster, and then Napster, you know, was sued out of existence. Then he created Plaxo until he got caught doing cocaine, and then they took Plaxo away from him. And then he was the first president of Facebook until he got caught doing cocaine, although he says it wasn't his cocaine. So, anyway, Sean was the cool guy. He sees Facebook, and so he comes to New York and meets with Mark and Eduardo. Mark is in awe of this guy. He loves Sean. Eduardo thought that Sean was like a snake oil salesman. He's like, we don't need this guy. But Mark was totally infatuated with him. Mark moves to California, and Sean ends up moving in with him in an apartment, and they essentially create the next level of Facebook. Eduardo stays behind to finish school. He starts to realize he's being cut out of the process. So he starts to freak out, and he freezes Facebook's bank accounts. Now, at the time, there was about $18,000 in the bank accounts. So it wasn't a lot of money, but it was enough, you know, that it was all his money. He freezes it. Mark and Sean freak out, and they go to Peter Thiel, who was the PayPal guy. Peter Thiel puts up $500,000. It's also one of the greatest investments in history. But he says, who is this Eduardo guy? You've got to get rid of this Eduardo guy because he's not part of your company. So they invite Eduardo out to Silicon Valley. Eduardo walks into the room. There's a whole bunch of lawyers there. From Eduardo's point of view, those are his lawyers, he thinks. And they hand him some papers. He signs the papers. And he leaves. Now, Mark's point of view is that Eduardo should have known what he was doing. He was the CFO of the company. Those were Facebook's lawyers. He ended up signing away all of his shares. So he gets back home and he realizes he no longer owns any of Facebook. So he sues. The Winklevii at this point realize that Facebook has gone on and passed them by and they're not part of it. So they sue. And that's when I came into the story. Eduardo was not supposed to be talking to anybody. He was in the midst of this massive lawsuit. He was, about to be sort of get nothing. They were going to give him nothing. They were holding on. This lawsuit would have gone on for 10 more years. He was talking to me probably to try and force Facebook's hands. He didn't actually think I was going to write a book, I don't think. I ended up writing a 14-page book proposal. I sent it to my agent. My agent sent it to a couple of publishers, and it leaked out onto the internet. So that day, suddenly it was everywhere. And this is the first time I think a whole book proposal ended up on the internet. Everything freaked out at once. Eduardo went crazy because he wasn't supposed to be talking to anybody, cut off all contact with me, sent me a legal restraining order saying I could never speak to him again. Facebook freaked out. They settled with Eduardo for $2 billion. I know. Part of the suit said that Eduardo was never allowed to speak to Ben Mezrich again. Now, for $2 billion, I'm pretty sure Josh would never speak to me again. That's a lot of money. So I understand. I wouldn't mind a gift basket, maybe some fruit of the month or something. But, also, Aaron Sorkin sees the book proposal. So I get a call from Aaron Sorkin, and he says he wants this to be his next movie. I mean, that's a home run for a writer. I mean, he's the most amazing screenwriter. David Fincher sees it and says, I want to direct this movie, but I only want to do it if we can make it right now, because who knows if Facebook will be around in 2 years. So I was like, this is fantastic. But the only problem was, I hadn't actually written anything yet. I had a 14-page book proposal, and that's all. So basically, I sat in a hotel room. I wrote this book. Aaron Sorkin came out to Boston, and I handed him chapter by chapter. He wrote the screenplay in about 4 weeks, and it became The Social Network, which was one of the most amazing movies, I think, of the, if King's Speech hadn't come out at the same time, it would have been the Oscar winner for Best Picture, but it ended up being, an incredible project. And from there, and I'll get into sort of my last project, and it was called Sex on the Moon. And it, again, came about. I was sitting at home, and The Social Network had just come out, and I got a phone call, and this guy said, you have to hear the story of my friend, Tad Roberts. He'd just gotten out of prison. Now, I hate that start of a conversation, but and I try and stay away from people who just got out of prison. And he'd been in prison for a decade, so I knew he'd done something really bad. It turns out what he did was quite fascinating. This was a kid who grew up in Utah, a fundamentalist Mormon household, was kicked out of his home at 18 for having premarital sex. So he was decided to change his life. He decided he wanted to be an astronaut. Why not, right? So he learned how to fly planes. He learned how to scuba dive. He learned 5 languages. He was a brilliant kid. He ended up getting into the Johnson Space Program. He was on his way to the astronaut training program. He was in a co-op program. And then he fell in love with a 19-year-old girl, decided to impress her by breaking into a secret lab and stealing a 600-pound safe full of moon rocks from every moon landing in history. The most valuable collection in the world. Moon rocks are illegal to own. They're worth $5 million an ounce. They were brought back by hand from the astronauts. He takes these moon rocks, he spreads them on a bed and has sex with his girlfriend on the moon, and then attempts to sell the moon rocks over the internet. So it's not, master criminal, right? He literally writes an email that he puts on all these blogs all over the world that says, anybody want to buy a moon rock? It ends up catching the attention of a mineral collector in Antwerp, Belgium. This is a guy who's never been out of Antwerp, and he's in his 50s. Him and a bunch of other men meet in an old cafeteria and trade rocks with each other. His wife is named Crystal. This guy is actually perfect as well. He's right out of Central Casting. He sees this ad, and he starts to think something weird is going on. So he starts negotiating with Tad Roberts, who's calling himself Orb Robinson on the email, and is actually writing these emails from NASA computers. This guy is a master criminal. basically, this Antwerp, Belgium guy realizes that this kid actually knows what he's talking about is probably at NASA. So he writes the FBI in Tampa an email and says, I think someone is trying to sell moon rocks. And the FBI's response is, what are moon rocks? Because they had never heard of anything like this. But they begin a case file. It ends up developing into this massive manhunt. They catch him in a restaurant in Orlando, Florida, using 100 agents, helicopters. They close down the main road in Orlando. They take him into custody. He remembers walking into a restaurant where every person there was an FBI agent. And all he noticed was that everyone in the room was between the ages of 30 and 40, which is odd for an Orlando restaurant. It was because everyone there was an agent. They take him down, and he's sentenced to a decade in prison. He had just gotten out and wanted to tell his story. So I basically met him in a hotel, and I was meeting a guy who'd spent 10 years in jail. So I met him in a crowded place because I didn't know what he was going to be like. The nicest guy, you know, gives me a big hug, really sweet. He was just someone who'd done something really, really stupid. He says for love. It wasn't really for money because he tried to sell him for $100,000. The collection was probably worth $1 billion or half $1 billion. It was really just to be special or to do something special or out of love or whatever. I was blown away, so I wrote the book, Sex on the Moon, and we're making that movie as well with the same people who did The Social Network. So that would be the next one. And then one final thing, because I guess we have a little more time, my new book comes out in May, and it's called Straight Flush. I'm back to sort of the Vegas thing. I know my mom keeps saying, don't write about Vegas anymore, but it's not really about Vegas. It's about a group of fraternity brothers at University of Montana in 1999 who essentially launched the entire online poker world. They moved their fraternity to Costa Rica and launched Absolute Poker and Ultimate Bet, which grew into the biggest online poker casino, basically. They were making $1 million a day living in this Wild West kind of scenario. And when the government decided what they were doing is illegal, and now they're all fugitives. One's stuck on Antigua, which isn't a bad place to be stuck, but he's been there a long time. One's stuck in Panama, and it's about the whole kind of world of online poker and these kind of crazy cowboys who built it. And that comes out in May, maybe I'll be back to sign books. But, you know, I figured at this point I would open it up to questions. I'm happy to answer questions about anything, except for surgery, I'll bring Josh up to answer any of those questions. And anything anybody wants to ask. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you. Wow. Beat the Dealer, right. Right.
And so we would gather our money for the weekend, usually somewhere between $5 and $10, and try to count cards.
Yeah.
And it didn't work, except the big change that they made since Thorpe was that they no longer use single.
Right. They moved into six deck. Right. Yeah, and I should say, first of all, Thorpe's book, Beat the Dealer, is what inspired the MIT Blackjack team. Thorpe was a visiting professor at MIT and a professor out in California, and ended up, by the way, going into investment banking and creating a big fund, and still involved, you know, was involved in counting in a different way. But the six-deck shoe did definitely change the game, but you still have a lot of time to make money. So what happens is it takes a lot longer till you get to the point where you're in a good section of the deck, but then you might have a period of time where you can play at that good point. So yes, it did change it, but the team that I wrote about always worked with six deck shoes. As long as it's not automatic shufflers. You know, Vegas has tried to move into the automatic shufflers, which shuffle every hand, and of course that makes card counting impossible. But nobody wants to play those decks. And so the casino has made a decision, we'd rather lose a little bit of money to these MIT kids than change the whole game of blackjack. So the six deck shoe is still beatable. But you know, you kind of need a team, because if you don't have a team, you can only play these tiny amounts, you know, small margins. If you try and raise your bet from $10 to $10,000, they're going to see what you're doing very quickly. So you should get a team together. Yeah. Yeah. That's true. That is true. You do get free drinks. And I will tell you something. The MIT team would, you can't not drink, because if you're not drinking, it looks very odd. So what the MIT team would do is actually they would carry thermoses with apple juice. And they would get a scotch, and they would go to the bathroom and dump the scotch out and put apple juice in their drink. And so the MIT kids were sitting around drinking apple juice while playing blackjack. But, yeah. Sure.
I have, that was a great comment. I might have something here. I guess I have two questions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in life and in papers, yes, yes, yes. Go on.
It's hard to deal with. You know, in the beginning, you had so many rejections.
I did.
I'm curious how you were able to persist and how you knew it would work out at some point. Because
right.
At some point, you think that you say this is not going to work out.
Well, I didn't have another choice, really. I had no backup plan. Again, my parents are here, so I have to be quiet about this. But. I really, really wanted to be a writer since I was 12 years old. This is pretty much all I ever wanted to do. And I pretty much decided, you know, it was the movie The Terminator, and there's a scene in The Terminator where they describe what a Terminator is, and they're like, this is absolutely all he does, and he will not stop until you're dead. And it was that kind of mentality where the rejection inspires you. And now I look back on it, and that was the most romantic period of my writing career. Because it becomes a business very later on. Now it's, you know, dealing with, you know, agents and lawyers and publicists. And at that time, it was you and a typewriter or a computer and rejections. And every rejection I got, I would just put it on the wall. I remember some of them are just awful. The New Yorker was the one that would, it's a full blank page, and in the middle, it just says no. I was like, wow, okay, that's pretty intense right there. I don't know if they still do that one, but it's like, wow. That is a no. There's no equivalent, you know, no waffling on that. That's an absolute no. And I bet they do that because everybody tries to read into a rejection slip. You're like, well, did they like it a little bit? And they're like, no, they did not like it. I don't know. I was, you know, listen, I was a geeky kid, as you know, to some degree. I never weighed 100 pounds as a senior in high school, so I was used to rejection. But I felt like this is part of it, you know? And you read the stories of people like Stephen King, who was rejected. His first book, Carrie, was rejected 28 times, and then he threw it in the garbage, and his wife took it out of the garbage and sent it, and he sold it. And you read about someone retyped The Yearling and sent it out, and it got 120 rejection slips. So it's like the publishers don't necessarily know, but it's true. You have to have a kind of a crazy ego in that you have to truly believe that even though what you're doing is getting rejected, that you will not stop doing it. But I'm fully aware that it could have ended much worse. You know, careers are hard. And even after I was selling books, I wasn't actually selling books. I mean, my first six thrillers did not make back their money. It wasn't until Bringing Down the House, which was my seventh book, that I had a successful book. So it's a bizarre career, but I think you just have to decide this is all I'm going to do. And you know, when I talk to colleges and high schools, I really tell the kids the same thing that my dad told me is give yourself a year or give yourself 2 years. Make a time limit because you don't want to drift because writing can end up nowhere. And I know a lot of people who do end up nowhere. Give yourself 2 years, and if you're not making some marked progress at the end of those 2 years, you have to try and find a job and then write on the side. I was fortunate in that within the 2 years I got an agent and got a book deal. But you know what? Rejection is part of the game, and rejection is the fun part of the game because you're trying. You're sending it. You would go to the mail. I'd go to the post office. This was pre-email, right? So you'd go to the post office every day, and you'd send out these massive packages, and then you'd come back and you'd get the massive packages, and it was just part of the game. And eventually, you know, you break in. Yeah. I don't know what to say other than rejection. Everyone faces rejection in their life. It's just part of it, you know, and you have to kind of go over that wall. But yeah, sure.
So as Josh implied, it's an academic medicine.
Right.
Writing is a really important part of that.
Yeah.
You know, having been involved in this for quite a number of years, some people can do it and others can't.
Right.
And so I've always tried to understand what the difference between the mind of somebody who's capable of doing that.
Right. Yeah. Well, I firstly think reading is a big part of it. I mean, you have to read and read and read and read. The amount, I think it was the Malcolm Gladwell. I hate to quote Malcolm Gladwell because he's a much more successful author than me, but, 10,000 hours or whatever it is. I mean, the amount of reading that I did before I wrote my first book was an enormous amount of reading. But I do think some of the stuff is innate and some of it is learned. You know, I don't think going to a writing school is necessary. All the people who go to journalism school or whatever. To write for newspaper you do, but to write what I write, that's just a place to make connections and things like that. It's just a matter of sitting there and writing. I mean, I wrote before, you know, nine novels that didn't sell before I wrote one that was good. Other people write one novel nine times and then sell it. Not saying that's the best process in the world. It's certainly a long, drawn-out, painful process. I don't know. I mean, it's a good question. I think I've always thought visually and see visually, and I write very cinematically. So some people like the way I write and some people don't. But for me, it's almost like writing a movie every time I write a book. Some people think differently. You also have to write something that people want to buy. I think that's another thing. I'm a very commercial type of writer. There are plenty of great writers out there who simply will never sell anything because they just don't write. They write poetry or they write whatever, and it's just there's no market for these things. I don't know. It's a good question. You know, writing in the medical field, you know, it's a very different style, obviously. I mean, Josh was telling me that you actually have to pay to get something published. It's very different rather than them paying you. You know, I think it's a different style of writing, but there are a lot of doctors who became, you know, fiction writers as well who've been very successful. I think it's writing something for an audience is the key, and then just going for it. But it's a good question. I mean, what is it mentally that makes one able to write? And there are certainly a lot of times when you're sitting there and you think you aren't able to write anymore, it's an odd thing. I don't know what it is. You know, it's kind of weird, sorcery, magical, and also the most horrible thing in the world sometimes. But it ends up working sometimes. So yeah, sure. Oh, yeah.
The industry is changing a lot. Amazon's got, you know, these novellas like published. And also, with the digitalization, is there an opportunity to get closer to your readership so you can communicate with them, you know, by email? And,
yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, we're in a massive state of change right now. The hardcover book is on its last legs. No question about that. The hardcover book, to my mind, in what I do, will not exist in 10 years. There's just no point to it. It's very expensive. Nobody buys hardcover anymore. They're just going down and down and down. And paperbacks, I think, will survive a little bit longer, especially because of airports. But it's all going to go digital. It's all going to go on the Kindles or the iPads. I have a Kindle, and I read my books on a Kindle, and I feel bad about it, but it's really great. So it's a, you know, you can't fight that battle. You are getting closer to your audience now. In a weird way, it's almost like a communication thing. You write a book and you're immediately talking to people about it, and it's an odd thing. I've been reading a lot about the guy who writes Game of Thrones, which I'm fascinated by. His audience is very upset at him because he's not finishing his new book. To the point where when he goes to a football game, he gets thousands of angry emails saying, how dare you not be in your apartment writing or your home writing? And he's been responding saying, I'm allowed to do whatever I want. And it's become this weird battle where his fans feel ownership over his next book. And he's an unhealthy guy, and he's very large, and people are telling him he should be on a diet so he can write his next book. So there is kind of this give and take that never existed before. You have to be on Twitter, you have to be on Facebook, you have to communicate, and there's immediate kind of response when you write something. But I do think we're losing something very sad by not having books anymore. I remember when you used to go on an airplane or a train, and you'd see what everybody was reading, you know, and that kind of created moments in writing, and now you see Kindles, and it's like, you don't know what anybody's reading or writing. I mean, they should put a cover on the back of the Kindle that appears. It's definitely changing the environment. I have a 3-year-old and a 9-month-old, and I'm thinking the world they're coming into is going to be absolutely different in terms of the book. There will be no book business. There will be Amazon. And the publishers are fighting Amazon right now. There's no reason why a Kindle book costs $12.99. There is no good reason for that. That is simply because the publishers banded together and decided that that was the price. This is the same thing the record company tried to do, right? And Napster killed it. Eventually, a Kindle will be $1.99. Or 99 cents. And then when that happens, writing books as a career will be finished. You'll have to write other content. Now there's movies, there's TV, there's different ways to sell books. But the problem, I think, is that it doesn't mean, you know, 99 cents isn't mean you're going to necessarily sell that many more because there's a limited number of readers. It will simply just lower the amount of money that everyone's going to be sharing from. So I do think Amazon eventually will kill writing as a business. But on the other hand, that is the future that you have to deal with. So I think writers on the whole have to get very savvy about the other industries that use their content. You have to know what's going on in Hollywood, and the synergy with television and movies and the internet is part of the business now. And so the writers who avoid that are eventually going to become dinosaurs like the casino guys. So there's good and bad in that. You know, the book will change. Libraries will be different. Libraries will just be Kindles or computer screens. But, yeah. Yeah.
You know, for some other writers, certainly the prestige is getting there. How have things changed now in Hollywood as you as a writer? Did you get into that?
Me personally? I mean, I've been very fortunate in the two movies that I've been involved with have ended up being successful. So I do get to, you know, be on set. But you're on set and nobody really wants you there. You're not really, you can be there and hang out with the actors and stuff, but you don't really have any power because you sell your project to them. There are different types of sets. 21 was a really fun set. It was in Vegas. We were in Vegas and we were in Boston and it was hanging out, and eventually me and the MIT kids got banned from the set because everybody was partying too hard. The MIT kids were consultants on the set, which was funny because we're in Vegas and the casinos did not want these guys there, but they couldn't kick them out. So they made a rule that none of the MIT kids could come within 25 feet of a blackjack table. So they would have to stand in the back while everyone was sitting at the blackjack tables. But there was one night where Kevin Spacey and Kate Bosworth wanted to go gambling with Jeff. So they brought him and had him sit at the table. And the casinos would never throw Spacey and Kate Bosworth out. So he card counted with them all night long. Kevin Spacey won $40,000 at the table. It was very upsetting to the casinos. So that was a fun set. But then The Social Network was not a fun set. David Fincher, and I think he's a genius, is not a fun guy. I like David a lot, but I mean, that set was terrifying from the minute you walked on to the minute you walked off. I remember they were shooting one scene, and all it was a bus pulls up in front of a fake finals club and two people get out. That's all the scene was. 30 seconds, maybe. They shot that scene from 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. They reshot that scene hundreds of times, just pulled up, okay, do it again. Do it again. Every actor, it was freezing cold, it was like the middle of the winter, and they just shot it and shot it and shot it and shot it, and that's what he does. He shoots things 24 hours per 30 seconds and then chooses the best one. And so that set was like, wow, this is just a grind. And so different sets are very different. You do go to a lot of Hollywood stuff, like Oscars and things like that, and that's a big fun, but it's stupid fun. Like, you can't take it seriously. As a book writer, I don't have to sort of spend my time dealing, you know, in the business side of that much. So I can just go and have a good time. And, you know, there's a moment where you look up and you're like sitting next to Nicole Kidman and you're like, wow, hey, what's going on here? But nobody knows who you are. I remember, you know, I think it was the guy from Nine Inch Nails had won an Oscar for our movie. So he gave me the Oscar to carry around the party. And I'm walking around a party and all these actors are like, oh, congratulations. And they're like, oh, thanks. I didn't win this. It was really fun. So it's that kind of thing. But, you know, you're not respected like a director is respected or an actor is respected. Their project could not exist without you. But they give you money, they pay for it, and then they want you to kind of go away. I think their favorite author is a dead author. I know when they made, The Dragon Tattoo Story, that author had just died, and that was kind of a perfect situation for Hollywood. it's sad, I guess. But no, there are, you know, it's fine, it's fine. You know, I'm not grumbling about it, it's worked out. So, yeah. Oh, wow. What should say? Well, you know, listen, I think that, Josh, what do you think? Listen, sir, the thing about writing is it truly is a very hard thing to break into. There's no path. I remember when I first started writing and I ran into somebody at the party who was not the brightest person in the world, and he was like, you want to be a writer? Where do you get an application to do that? And I was like, there is no application to do that. I think that medicine is, you know, to me personally, medicine is the most amazing career. I'm a huge fan of, I mean, what you guys do daily. I mean, I've texted with Josh at 2 in the morning and I'll be in Vegas hanging out with, you know, a bunch of losers and he's in surgery or on his way to surgery. And I'm like, well, we're doing very different things here. I mean, there's much less, I guess, honor in what I do daily. But, it's very different. Writing is one of those careers where you have to make your own path. You have to find your own way. It's very, very hard to make a living at it. You have to do it because you love it. And eventually, if you love it enough and you're good enough, you might make a living at it. So it's kind of terrifying. I have kids now and I think to myself, well, if they decide they want to be writers, obviously I would say, oh, go for it. But I also know full well that it's not a path that necessarily works. In fact, 90% of the time it doesn't work, 99% of the time probably. So I don't know. There's no reason you can't do both. You just have to find a way to do it. I mean, obviously surgery is extremely hard, to finding the time to write. But John Grisham wrote The Firm, you know, on the subway to and from work every day. It took him 2 years, but that's how he wrote it. And a lot of writers have succeeded that way. So I feel like you've got to have a backup plan, although I did not. You know, I applied to law school and then deferred and deferred and deferred with no intention of ever going. That I had no intention of ever going. But you know, you have to, I can say it now, it's okay now. but yeah, I think it's hard, I think, as a parent now to understand, you know, if a kid comes up and says, I want to be a rock star, or I want to be a, you know, whatever, a professional tennis player, I want to be, you have to kind of gauge how good they are. And when I told you guys, I probably wasn't that good, and you were probably like, oh God, he's never going to make it as a writer. I think if they truly love it, you have to let them try. I mean, you know, it's if you really doing something you love for a living, I think is better than anything in the world. Whatever it is that you love, if you love it, that's the only thing you should do. So I don't know. I don't know the answer to that question, but I would say go for it. I did a writing summer school. I did Harvard summer school and I took writing classes, and so it gave me a whole summer to just write when I was 17. And I think that was a wonderful experience for me. Not because it helped me get anywhere, but because it just let me be a writer for a summer and know what that meant. And so you kind of have to see. I mean, she probably doesn't know what it really means to be a writer yet. I mean, she hasn't sat at home all day staring at a blank page while all your friends are actually making. Oh, okay, good. Well, yeah. I mean, so, you know, if she really loves it and wants to do it, I would say go for it. I hope I'm not giving bad advice. But, you know, medicine's a great backup plan. No, I'm just kidding. Sure.
So you said you started out reading a lot.
Right. Didn't like it as a kid, no.
And so who would you consider the
Well, at the time, so my dad or my parents in the basement had this huge library, mostly science fiction. So I think I read majority of science fiction. I became obsessed with Michael Crichton. I really wanted to be Michael Crichton. I wanted to be him as a writer and television and everything. And so that was where I was modeling my career. And he did do both fiction and nonfiction. Then Hunter S. Thompson became a huge influence on my life. When I started writing nonfiction, I was like, wow, if I could be Hunter S. Thompson without the drugs and the guns, that would be me. Yeah, he went a little overboard, but he was, you know, the ability to write nonfiction as fiction, you know, as a thriller, not really worry so much about being a journalist, but telling the story, which became the most important thing. And then I get, you know, attacked a lot in the press because of the way I write, but I see Hunter S. Thompson as a huge influence. You know, I read everything. Nowadays, I definitely read most things that come out that are big stories and big books, but still not that much nonfiction. I'm not the guy who's going to read that John Adams book or the, you know, Lincoln book, even though I know those are great books, because I just can't get through them. But I will read Michael Lewis sometimes, although my brother's obsessed with Michael Lewis. It drives me crazy. He's very, you know, he's good. I don't see him here at 6:30 in the morning, but let's see. You call Michael Lewis and ask him to come at 6:30 in the morning, and you see if he shows up. I do not see that happening, Josh. but no, he's a very good writer. I think he's fascinating. I read Rolling Stone a lot. I think there are some great writers in Rolling Stone when they do like that one big story, you know, about the, you know, the WikiLeaks or whatever. They do one great story and issue, and I think there's some phenomenal writing going on there. But I'm you know, I read Game of Thrones, you know, and I love television and Mad Men and all those things. So my influences have changed a lot. But I would say my initial influence was definitely Michael Crichton. And then all the sci-fi writers of the 60s and 70s and 80s. But I think that's it, yeah. But, you know, I think the key to being a writer also is to find your voice. It took me a long time to find what I was good at. My thrillers did not do that well. It wasn't until I kind of blended nonfiction and fiction that I became successful. It took me many years to figure out what worked for me. And I think all writers are that way. When you start out, you might be trying to write like another writer. Like I was trying to write like Bret Easton Ellis, and I simply was not succeeding at that. Or trying to write like Michael Crichton. I mean, I'm not Michael Crichton. So eventually you have to find your voice. And I think for your daughter, I think that's the key. It can take, you know, you never know when you're going to suddenly, maybe she can write great children's books, or maybe she can write, there's so many different forms of writing. The key is to figure out what it is you're really good at. And so for me, you know, my influence was Michael Crichton, but I think when I discovered Hunter S. Thompson, it's when I kind of figured out how I could write. Maybe a blend of those two styles is what I've tried to do. But yeah, I don't know, reading, you know, everything. Sooner or later you find someone who you want to write like. Yeah? Yeah. No. See, I'm in Boston, and I never, you know, graduated from college, and I had to decide, am I going to be a struggling writer in New York or a struggling writer in Boston? And being struggling in New York just seemed like a horrible thing to do. Plus, everyone I know who moved there to become a writer did not become a writer, because there's just too much going on. Boston closes down at 1 in the morning, and I was a nighttime writer. So every night at 1 in the morning, from 1 to 6 in the morning, I would write. Nobody was around. There was nothing to do. In New York, you know, it never ends, right? So you just keep going and going and going. I don't think you have to be anywhere. If you want to be a screenwriter, you have to be in L.A. I really believe that, because you have to be in the business and talking and dealing with everybody. But if you want to write books for a living, you can be anywhere. You know, yeah, nowadays with the internet and everything, you can also self-publish, and all that stuff is growing. It hasn't yet gotten to the point where I would ever recommend someone trying to do that. I'd still try and go the traditional route of getting an agent and getting a publisher in New York. But you can do that from anywhere. I mean, most of the great writers of our generation do not live in New York. In the 80s, they all lived in New York. And that's why I kept thinking I had to live in New York and write like that. But, you know, since then, most of the successful writers do not live in New York. I think it's just a matter of writing in an area that you know well, that gives you the time to write. Breaking in is still pretty much similar, as you have to get an agent, and you have to get an agent to sell your book to a publisher. If you self-publish, every now and then you hear about these stories of an Amazon bestseller that becomes this huge thing, like 50 Shades of Grey or something like that. That's one in a million. You know, there are tens of thousands of really crappy 50 Shades of Grey. Well, 50 Shades of Grey is pretty crappy too, but there are tens of thousands of crappy versions of that that never find an audience. So I don't think yet that is a viable business. It will eventually be viable to self, you know, go on Amazon. But I think right now it's still get an agent and then get a publisher. But you don't have to be in New York. In fact, they don't even want you there. You know, it's very different than like living in LA and having to make it as a screenwriter. They want to see your manuscript, and if it's great, they'll publish it, and if it's not, they won't. They're pretty much, it's still a meritocracy in publishing. It really isn't a connection game. It isn't a, because they just don't care. If it's not going to sell, they don't really want to publish it. So, you know, I think you can live anywhere. Certainly, there are plenty of great writers who live, you know, who don't, most of them don't live in New York, I would think. Yeah.
Well, Ben,
oh.
I think we got a
yes. One quick announcement.
Oh.
We have Ben's book, we have some copies in the bookstore if you want to buy one. He signed some in advance.
But I did.
If we run out, if you can get the book up to my office before 10:30,
I'll be there. So, absolutely.
All right.
Thank you all very much. This was really wonderful. Thank you.